morning, saints, and welcome to worship on this beautiful Sunday here with us at Christ Lutheran Church. Just one welcoming announcement to bring to your attention. I want to say first a profound word of thanks for all those who brought food and gift card donations for Field Elementary this week. Two full carloads went to the school on Thursday morning, and that is a tremendous gift of the heart in the name of Christ. And so thank you very much for your generosity. Our next food drive will be November 17th and 18th, and that food drive will go to the Sheridan Food Pantry. So again, we continue to serve as disciples in this community, bringing forth that love of God to our neighbors. So thank you for your continued generosity there. Also, a word of thank you to Randy Patz and Jenny Almer for helping us as volunteers in worship today as we do live stream out. Thank you very much. And Peyton and Ben, always great to be with you in worship. Thank you for being here on this Sunday morning and leading us in worship as well. And Pastor Gail, looking forward to a wonderful message in a few moments as we continue in worship. And that is what we do now. We prepare our hearts for worship. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who creates, redeems, and sustains us and all of creation. Amen. Together we confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Holy One, we confess that we are not awake for you. We are not faithful in using your gifts. We forget the least of our siblings. We do not see your beautiful image in one another. We are infected by sin that divides your beloved community. And so we pray that you would open our hearts to your coming, open our eyes to see you in our neighbor, open our hands to serve your creation. Amen. Beloved, we are God's children. And Jesus, our beloved, opens the door to us. Through Jesus, you are forgiven. By Jesus, you are welcome. And in Jesus, you are called to rejoice. Let us live then in the promise prepared for us from the foundation of the world. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Oh,
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. If you would join your hearts with me in prayer. O God of justice and love, you illumine our way through life with the words of your Son. Give us the light that we need, and awaken us to the needs of others. For this we ask through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, from within the 25th chapter. Jesus said to the disciples, "Then the kingdom of heaven will be like this. 10 bridesmaids took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish, and 5 were wise. When the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them, but the wise took a flask of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, all of them became drowsy and slept. But at midnight there was a shout, 'Look, here comes the bridegroom. Come out to meet him.' Then all those bridesmaids got up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish said to the wise, 'Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out.' But the wise replied, 'No, there will not be enough for you and for us. You had better go to the dealers and buy some for yourselves.' And while they went to buy it, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went with him into the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the other bridesmaids came also, saying, 'Lord, Lord, open to us.' But he replied, 'Truly I tell you, I do not know you. Keep awake, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour.'" The Gospel of our Lord. And we welcome Connor for the children's message.
Awesome. Hi, everybody. Today we heard our reading, if you guys are paying attention to it, it talks about this party and waiting for this party and getting ready for it. But the thing is that I suck at getting ready. Like, I am just never ready for the occasion that happens. I'm always 5 minutes late. I'm always unprepared for that. Planning ahead for parties means that you get to go to the parties, and if you don't plan ahead, then sometimes you show up too late and you don't get to go. And this story is about being invited to God's party. So I want to help you guys out a little bit and talk a little bit how you guys are already invited to God's party and how you guys can be ready for that awesome party. I think you can get ready for God by looking for God. Finding places that are beautiful around you, where the good things are happening. So when you're walking outside and it's snowing, or it's sunny outside and it's just beautiful, or this fresh smell like cookies coming from your oven, or when your sibling does something nice for you or your parents, these are all things that you can look for God in. And those help us be ready for the party that God invites us to be in. You can also be ready for God just by being who you are. God created you and made you just as the person that you are right now. And so if you live into that and love yourself and love your neighbors and love who you are, God is inviting you to his party, and there will for sure be some awesome cake at that party. Amen.
Thank you, Connor. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Preparation. Being prepared. What are you preparing for? You know, we seem to be talking a lot about being prepared in these pandemic days, as we share information about where to find Clorox wipes, paper towels, and various food items. I'm amused by one of our church members posting that he can't find the vegetable okra for his jambalaya recipe. Preparation. When we moved to Japan in 2011 following the massive earthquake in Tohoku, we learned the essential preparations in case of another earthquake. For example, we always kept a pair of shoes by our bedside in case our earthquake should hit at night, so that we wouldn't have to walk over broken items and glass in bare feet. And we had an emergency backpack stored near the entryway that contained copies of our legal papers, emergency contact instructions, with things like a flashlight, a first aid kit, a bottle of water, reflective vest to wear, things like that. You know, being prepared in the foothills of Colorado meant different things. We taught our children how to be prepared, especially in winter driving. They kept working flashlights, an extra pair of gloves, an extra coat, a sleeping bag in the back of the car should they get caught in one of our strange winter storms that just come out of nowhere. Being prepared can mean the difference between life or death, danger or safety, or simply enjoying life versus being anxious. In our scripture today, we heard that one half of the bridesmaids were not prepared for the long night of celebration. They didn't bring extra oil for their lamps. Half of the bridesmaids were prepared, but the other half were not. How anxious those unprepared bridesmaids must have felt. But you know, I admit that there are disturbing elements to this story as well. Those who had didn't share with those who did not. It seems to go against the stories that we read in the Bible. And the five who were prepared, who were not prepared, were told to go out and get their own oil, which evidently they did. But then they weren't allowed into the wedding party. They knocked on the door and begged for the groom to let them in, and he replied that he didn't know who they were. And the closing words are, "Keep awake," or "Keep alert, for we know not the hour or the day." First, I want to say that we don't base our theology of salvation on just one scripture lesson. If we are thinking of salvation, we can point to other verses in Matthew. For example, in Matthew 7, where these words are, "Ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you shall find. Knock, and the door will be opened for you. For everyone who asks receives, and for those who seek, they find. And to those who knock, the door will be opened to you." And we know that it's never too late to ask, for we see the story of the thief on the cross next to Jesus, where they're both dying, and the thief says, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus replied, "Today I tell you, you will be with me in paradise." So, if this parable isn't to scare us into repentance because we might not be allowed into God's kingdom, what does it mean? Well, let's think about this. We have been given the greatest gift of all, the gift of unconditional love, of continued forgiveness and salvation for our sin. We have been included in the family of God and invited into a life of purpose and meaning. And maybe the question begs, what are we going to do with this gift? Are we being complacent because our salvation is assured? Or are we honoring this gift by living as a follower of Christ, loving intentionally, by loving God with our heart, our mind, and our strength, and by loving our neighbors as ourselves? Imagine if you were given a very fancy car, the car of your dreams. I'll let you pick out your own car in your own mind. Got it? Okay, you're given this car by someone who loves you. and wants you to have this fabulous gift. You are so excited, you're grateful to the gift giver, and you probably go out and you show everybody this wonderful gift you received, this fabulous car, and you tell them about the gift giver who gave you this car. But then, you never take the car in for an oil change or for a tune-up. You just keep driving it and driving it, complacently believing it's always going to be available to you. Well, we know complacency can ruin a car, and it can also ruin relationships. Really, we can name many different examples of gifts that have been received with great joy, honor, and respect that still need to be tended, nurtured, and cared for. Rather than being complacent, we need to be intentional about our gift of faith, our relationship with God and with others. Think about it. When were you last passionate about your faith? Maybe at a retreat where you felt so close to God. During a particularly moving worship service, or with music. Music seems to always draw us closer to the holy and open our hearts to the sacred. Maybe you felt particularly close to God in a hospital room, our own or someone else's. Or when we were with a group of people of like-minded purpose, during a mission trip where all work together for the good of others. Or maybe a time when we intentionally spend time with God through prayer, meditation, reading the Bible. These are wonderful times of growth in our faith and cause this warm glow in our hearts. But they don't have to be the only time. We can have God-gifted faith daily by being intentional about our faith and not complacent. Consider some of these things that can be done to tune up our spiritual life. Of course, watching our worship services or our devotions online and joining us that way. Or having private devotions on your own. Reading the scriptures and asking God to give you thoughts about what this might mean for your life today. Consider intentionally spending time in prayer, caring for a neighbor, a friend, or a family member. In the book of Amos, we read that if you're feeling particularly down, lonely, depressed, that you're to reach out to someone else in the name of God, and that will help lift you. Or this is something we don't always talk about, but evangelism. Sharing your faith, sharing the meaning of your faith with someone else. Last week I received a handwritten letter from a woman asking me if I was having a hard time, if I had questions, if I would like to discuss what was going on, and she invited me into her congregation. Now, she doesn't know me, and I don't know her, but she had taken the time to write this letter, I don't know, to a group of people, maybe in my neighborhood, but I have to say I was intrigued and touched that someone took the time to write out a caring message of hope, of wanting to share her faith. There are many ways that we can grow our own faith, our God-given faith, our God-gifted faith, by doing acts of kindness, acts of devotion, acts of discipleship. And lastly, during the stewardship season, I want to talk to you about the church. Are we complacent about church? About Christ Lutheran? Or are we excited that God has allowed a holy and sacred ministry to be planted right here in Highlands Ranch, where babies, children, and adults are baptized, where couples have exchanged wedding vows with sacred words, where loved ones gather to honor the faith of another who has passed away, where children learn of Jesus, and that Jesus loves them, and that Jesus loves all people, where youth learn the tenets of faith and experience the living faith, where people learn, laugh, love, and live out their baptismal vows together. This holy and sacred ministry that allows those in need to be helped through the generosity of God's people at Christ Lutheran, where people connect through shared interest, concerns, experiences, and questions, where the gifts of grace are offered freely to all who wish to receive them, and where worship is offered faithfully, whether in the sanctuary, in the parking lot, or online. In these last 8 months, we have all experienced strange and confusing times as we maneuver the pitfalls of this pandemic. Shopping, working, worshiping, attending school, sports, and being with family and friends has taken a lot more effort, energy, and planning. We haven't been able to be complacent about life during these days. In fact, we've had to be very intentional. And I'm grateful for the many who continue to be intentional to be a part of God's ministry at Christ Lutheran. I want to list some of those. For last year's council, who stayed on extra months until the spring congregational meeting happened at the end of July. For the new council, who conscientiously stepped up to lead through these uncertain days. For those on the task force, who have regularly met to discuss data, what is happening in their professional settings, how to safely host worship in the parking lot, and then in the next steps, in keeping preschoolers, members, and staff safe. For the search team, who worked diligently to bring Connor Peterson in as the Director of Youth and Family Ministries. For the personnel team, who keeps in touch to support staff. For all the small groups that continue to contact one another via Zoom, telephone, email, and text. For the check-in leaders who communicate with their crews. For all of you who regularly contributed to the every other week food drives, for sharing with Sheridan and for Field Elementary. Families have been fed because of your generosity. And for the volunteers who received the food and then delivered it to these organizations. For the folks who continue to give financially to the church so that God's ministry can continue and that we can continue to provide support for our mission partners. For those who sent off our seniors with love and gifts, who hosted the trunk or treat. For the confirmation families who participated in reverse trick-or-treating for some of our seniors. And for the staff who quickly pivoted from in-person worship, in-person ministry, to questioning of how do we connect with our people now. Thanks to this amazing team, only one Sunday went by without a worship service. On a Thursday in March, we realized the gravity of the coronavirus and made the decision to suspend in-person worship and gatherings. By the following week, devotions were recorded and posted, and the very next Sunday, worship was held online. God's ministry is continuing on through you, through acts of service, through your financial support, and your prayers. This is not the time to be complacent, but to be intentional. This is time to make sure that the lamps of the church are filled with oil and that the extra flask is filled as well. When we hear that God wants us to act, we don't want to have to say, "Wait, Lord, wait, we need more oil, we need more resources." Let us be prepared so that when the Lord calls us with a need, with a way to reach out to others, with a way to reach out to you, we can boldly reply, "Yes, Lord, we are ready. We are. Where you lead, we will follow." Lead us, Lord, together as a church, as followers of Christ, and as children of God. For that we can say, thanks be to God. Amen.
Jesus is coming soon.
Together as a people of faith, we lift up and confess that Christian faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again, and he ascended into heaven, where he is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Surprise and delight us with the beauty of the world that you have made. Bless the work of landscapers, architects, and artists whose work invites us into harmonious living with all of your creation. We ask, Lord, in your mercy, to hear our prayer. Holy Companion, console those who feel lonely or abandoned. Share the hours with those who live and comfort those who have few friends or who struggle with their identity and place in this world. Today we pray for all those who are sick, especially those that we mentioned before you now. We ask, Lord, in your mercy, Holy Protector, be with all who are observing Veterans Day. Guard the lives of active duty and retired military personnel. Comfort all who mourn those who have died in the line of duty, to heal the wounds, both physical and mental, experienced by service members. We ask, Lord, in your mercy, to hear our prayer. Holy and immortal one, we pray in thanksgiving for the lives of all who have died. Remind us of the frailty and shortness of our own lives, and inspire us to use them for the building up of your kingdom, especially those who we give thanks and remembrance before you now. Our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, until that day when you gather all creation around your throne, where you will reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. At this time, I invite you to share that peace with those who are around you or that you may reach out to, and then briefly afterwards, may begin preparing your elements for Holy Communion together. be with you. Lift up your hearts as we lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God, for it is right to give God our thanks and praise. The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks, and gave it for all people, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Fellow beloved children of God and siblings of Christ, the body and blood of Christ given and shed for you, receive these gifts of grace. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, we pray as our Lord Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now may these gifts of God in Christ Jesus, both word and flesh, strengthen you and keep you in his grace now and always. Amen. A couple of sending announcements for us on this Sunday, November 8th. Reminder that the congregational meeting is today in about 45 minutes at around 11:30 via Zoom link. That link was sent out to you by email earlier this week on Good Friday. And so please look for that. In that email, you will also see the attachment for the updated constitution as well as the agenda that includes the presentation of the 2021 budget. And so please look for that as we look to convene that meeting in 45 minutes or so. Also, giving statements for 2020 year to date and the pledge cards went out in the mail this week. So please look for those in your mailboxes. A word of thanks for Jeff Bergstrom and Bill and Barb Doyle for their efforts and working with me to make sure that that happened this week. And then also, we give you thanks for the patience that we have experienced here in making sure that we can continue to do worship by live stream as we're learning some of this new technology that we've received. And so, Peyton, thank you for your leadership efforts there to oversee that process as we continue to care for the important important need of our worship together and to give God glory. So thank you for that as well. Receive the benediction on this Sunday and in the days ahead, that may the God of all creation, in whose image we are all made, who claims us and calls us beloved, who strengthens us for service, and who gives you reason to rejoice and be glad, the blessings of God, Sovereign, Savior, and Spirit, be with you today and always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the risen Lord. Thanks be to God.
This is my story.